First of all, I want to thank the praise team for picking out some wonderful songs for us to sing as a congregation. Songs that actually center around the theme of tonight or today's message, No Turning Back. Now, last week, we talked a little bit about how we need to express love to one another. We took a look at the story of the Good Samaritan, recognizing that our neighbor isn't just the person across the street or next door to us. It can extend even beyond those borders. Well, today we're looking at how we need to love God, to love Him so deeply that then we are able to express Him vividly. And I need to say that there's going to be moments in the message that you say, ouch, man, Pastor, what's that the bed that you wake up on this morning? But I want you to also know that anything I share that might prick you, I share because I've had to work through it myself. I place myself right where you're at today. And even though I'm the deliverer of the message, I'm also a receiver of what God has to say as well. We take a look at Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 through 9, and then also verses 13 through 14. The Apostle Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, pens these words. I once thought all these things were so very important, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything is worthless when compared with the priceless gain of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. I discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage. And the Greek word for garbage, as we learned a while back, is skabala, which really means dung or manure. In other words, that's how he looks at things in comparison to the glory of Jesus. So I count it all as garbage so I may have Christ and become one with him. Then jumping down to verse 13, no, dear brothers and sisters, I am still not all that I should be, but I am focusing all my energies on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. I strain to reach the end of the race and receive the prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us up to heaven. Well, as I was making preparation for the message, I came across a conversation that one fellow had with his friends, and he was bragging about his grandfather. And I don't know if they were having a bragging competition then, but he wanted to outdo the other kids, and he said, you know, my grandfather knew the exact day of the exact year when he was going to die. He thought, wow, that's pretty interesting. Well, not only that, he knew the time he would die and the day as well. And they say, well, how do you know all these things? Well, because a judge told him. I'll let that sink in for a few moments. Well, here we have an old man who's looking out some prison bars. He's seen this view so many times before. He's been arrested often. He's suffered numerous beatings, and it's funny how life kind of takes a twist, how sometimes life turns out, because he once was a man of great prominence. His family name carried influence. He was well-educated and respected. In other words, he had the right name, the right job, and the right social connections. But somehow, some way, he lost it all. Kicked out of his cushy job, now hated by his own family, even his one-time friends, they want him dead. Now, how do these things happen? How do you go from being a somebody and then almost overnight become a nobody? Well, with this gentleman, it was all because of the decision that he made in which he would never second guess. So there in that prison, the old man sits down. He grabs a pen with his arthritic fingers. Who knows how much time he's got left to tell his story? For all he knows, this could be his last letter. In fact, there's already circulation around town that's coming back into the prison cell that he will soon be executed. Powerful people want him dead. His family want him dead. His friends want him dead. But strangely, the old man, he's not afraid. So he squints down at his paper and he begins to write, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. For his sake, I suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as garbage in order that I may You recognize those words, don't you? In fact, you even recognize who wrote those words. The Apostle Paul penned them to paper almost 2,000 years ago. He penned them to the believers at the church in Philippi. How could a man who just lost everything write with such powerful, passionate words and write with such hope? A few years back, there was a lady by the name of Carolyn Johnson, 73 years old. She lost her house and all her possessions in a flood. So when the news reporters came and began to talk to her, they wanted to know how she was dealing with all this. And she said, "You know, I have to admit, in 73 years, I've never been in a situation like this. My house had everything, everything that I owned. Now I have nothing. All I have left is Jesus." As she said with a smile on her face. Well, I kind of guess that that's the situation Paul found in himself after his conversion. He lost everything. But like Carolyn Johnson, Paul could say, "You know what? I may not have anything now to call my own, but I have Jesus, and he's enough." And you know, as I look at it, that's not such a bad trade after all. Maybe it takes losing everything to discover the one most important thing that we ought to be hanging on to and grasping to. You know, we first meet the Apostle Paul in the book of Acts, chapters 7 and 8. At that time, he's a young Pharisee, not known by Paul, but by his real name, Saul. And Saul is of the tribe of Benjamin, one of the original 12 tribes of Israel. Wow, he has a family heritage that he can brag about. He can hang his hat on. Also, he was a native of Tarsus, which was a city capital, prosperous, a cosmopolitan type of place. And Tarsus is known for its great schools of learning. Therefore, as a native of that particular town, Saul was quite educated. And he also was a zealous member of the Pharisees, a group of Jewish scholars who believed deeply in the Mosaic law and living a life of purity. And they kept these laws on a daily basis. Now, you may not be familiar with this, because when we hear the name Pharisee, what do we think of? Hypocrisy, right? We think of those that are super spiritual, self-righteous, looking down on others. But the name itself means separated by special works. A Pharisee was separated to do God's business. However, because of the business they were doing, they began to think they were better than others. And so they developed this self-righteous spirit, and Saul had it very deeply ingrained within. That zeal for the law, he felt, set him above other people. Saul sees this new religious group that's starting out, this thing called Christianity. Of course, that thing was called the Way. They are blasphemers of the Jewish faith. So he devotes all his attention and energy into persecuting the church, even to the point of aiding in the murder of a young Christian evangelist by the name of Stephen. After Stephen's death, Saul heads towards Damascus. Why? To arrest more Christians, to persecute more Christians. But as he travels along that road, Saul is blinded by a flash of light. He's confronted by the voice of Jesus. And in a moment, Saul's life is forever transformed and changed. He becomes now Paul, a follower of Jesus. And the rest of his life is now devoted to spreading the good news of what Christ can do in a life. Now, if this were a fairy tale that I just shared, we'd close it right now by saying, "And everybody lived happily ever afterward." But you've read the story, right? And that's not the way it ends. Paul lost his position as a Pharisee. And now, his whole family and friends have turned against him. He also becomes the very victim of the same persecution he meted out to the church. Now it's coming back his way. Paul never again
had a home that he could claim as his own. And many times, he didn't even know where his next meal was going to come from. He spent years in prison, endured beatings and abuse. And eventually, he was executed by the ruling authorities of that day. All for the sake of Jesus Christ. And however, despite all that he experienced, his joy, his faith, his confidence never wavered. He gave up everything for the sake of the one thing that matters most. So let me just draw your thoughts to just several points this morning. The first is, you are never wrong to trade that which is temporal for that which is eternal. Makes sense, right? But boy, sometimes we have to come back to that fact. We have to come full circle. In Deadwood, South Dakota, there's a museum where you're going to find a very interesting inscription left by a beleaguered prospector. It says this: I lost my gun. I lost my horse. Almost sounds like a country western song. I'm out of food. The Indians are after me. But I've got all the gold I can carry. It's not helpful much, is it? Because everybody after him, everybody wants him. What good is the gold? He kind of got his priorities all messed up. But in Paul's situation, I don't think we have to wonder about his priorities. When he found salvation in Jesus Christ, it was worth more than any gold, more than any possession, more than any title could ever offer. You know, Joe DiMaggio once said about Marilyn Monroe, who committed suicide, these words: she had everything to live for, or to live with, but nothing to live for. Think of that for a moment. She had everything to live with. She had all the world before her, but she had nothing to live for. She still was empty inside. Well, in the life of the Apostle Paul, he had nothing to live with, but everything to live for. So here's a question that I'm posing to all of us, myself, even though I'm standing here on this platform. The question that might keep us awake at night, or probably should keep us awake at night: what would you or I have to lose in order to really find Jesus? In other words, what is standing in the way from keeping us to say yes to Jesus wholeheartedly? I mean, really throwing ourselves upon his mercy and grace like Paul did. What is it? We need to fill in the blank. Is it our social status? We just don't want to surrender that title. Is it our material possessions? Wow, I got a lot of stuff, and I don't want to release my stuff. But how about the desire for approval? We have a lot of Christians that have caved into the culture around them because they don't want to be looked down upon by their culture. Or how about spiritual apathy? Or the need to simply be in control? I don't want anybody else telling me what to do. I want to control my own affairs. How about self-centeredness? There was a post on Facebook a little bit ago that said, you know what? Scientists made this marvelous discovery. The world doesn't revolve just around you. And isn't it true? A lot of times we think the world revolves around us, and we ought to be the center of everything. It could be fear, it could be guilt, it could be shame. You fill the blank. But what is it that's keeping you from making a wholehearted commitment in following Jesus Christ? Believe it or not, for the Apostle Paul, there were many obstacles to overcome. There was the law of Moses, his family lineage, his own self-righteousness, even his social standing. But something gave Paul the ability to turn his back on all that he once considered important in order to embrace what he might embrace for eternity. That couldn't be taken away from him. The songwriter wrote these words: all I once held dear, built my life upon, all this world reveres and wars to own. All I once thought gain, I've counted loss, spent and worthless, now compared to this. Compared to what? Knowing you, Jesus. Knowing you. There is no greater thing. You're my all. You're the best. You're my joy, my righteousness. And I love you, Lord. Penned it well, didn't he? I'm willing to give up everything because nothing compares to the matchless glory of knowing Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. A story is told of a man who died and went to heaven. Just outside of heaven, in his dream, was a huge arena called the Court of Status Symbols. Now, before the man could get to heaven, he had to go through this arena, past the keeper of the door, and he entered the court. Inside the Court of Status Symbols, he saw sleek automobiles, membership cards to exclusive clubs, iPhone 8, maybe even iPhone X, silver-tipped canes, all kinds of wonderful things. And as he went further back into the room, he saw the crowns of kings and the jewelry of princesses. Then the guide said, yes, these are all the things that the world used to impress people. They're symbols of significance, but they don't impress God. So we have everybody drop them right here before they come and stand in the presence of the Almighty. When I was reading that, I thought, Lord, what do I need to drop at the Court of Status Symbols so that I can stand holy and righteous in your presence? We all need to ask that question, don't we? And that brings me to the next thought. Sometimes it takes a dramatic experience to bring things that are really important into focus. Joseph Todd was a minister student in England. He came from Romania, but was studying in England, and because of all the persecution happening in Romania, his professors and others convinced him that he probably needed to take a pastoralship right there somewhere in England. However, Joseph felt, no, I need to go back to my own people. I need to share Jesus to those in my homeland. He was told that if he went back, his life would be in danger, and his preaching would cause persecution. But he followed the will of God, and sure enough, the counsel he received back in England was true. He was persecuted. He was harassed. He was beaten. And one day, a particular police officer broke into his office, held a gun to his head, and threatened to kill him. Joseph responded to the officer by saying, sir, your supreme weapon is killing. My supreme weapon is dying. Again, how's the police officer handle that? Because all Joseph was saying, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. But he went on. He said, you see, sir, my sermons have been put on cassette tapes, and they're all through this countryside. You kill me, you sprinkle every message with blood. And he says, think about that for a moment. When people hear my message, they're going to say, ooh, we better listen to this because this man was willing to die for what he's preaching about. And he closed by saying, my servants will speak 10 times louder than before. So go on and kill me. I ultimately win the supreme victory. Well, as the story goes on, the police officer took down his gun, and through conversation, I believe he gave his own life to Jesus Christ. But after that day, Joseph never again doubted God's call on his life. He continued to preach without fear. And then he said this, and friends, I'm telling you that I also probably could place myself in what he's saying. He said, for years I was a Christian who was cautious because I wanted to survive. How many put your hands up saying, yeah, I think there's some truth in that statement. He said, I had accepted all the restrictions the authorities had put on me because I wanted to live. For years I wanted to save my life, and all along I was losing it. Now that I'm willing to lose my life, I find I am winning it. Powerful. William Mason spoke a challenging word concerning the nature of the Christian life. He said, the Christian life is called to live with Christ And that calling is not simply an improved version or an expansion of the life of the past, but a contradiction of that former life. I don't know if you understand what he's saying, but what he's saying is, when you find Jesus Christ, you better be a new creation. You ought to be a transformed individual. There ought to be things that are starting to happen in your life. Your language ought to be changing. Your behavior ought to be changing. Even sometimes your relationships and your associates ought to be changing. If you're the same person you were before you met Christ, and you value the same things you always valued before you met Christ, then it's time to stop and take inventory. Are your energies and attentions fragmented among a million different other concerns? Or like the Apostle Paul, do you have this one focus, one priority, to press on toward the goal to win the prize to which God has called you? I'm going to ask the praise team to come back to the platform as we share one final illustration. There was an esteemed philosopher that was asked to give a talk. I don't know if it was a lecture or exactly what, but at the University of the Chicago Divinity School. Now, this philosopher is supposed to support Christianity. However, when he got up there, he began to abuse his privilege. And he tried to prove that the resurrection of Jesus Christ was simply a myth. In fact, he quoted scholar after scholar and book after book. And then he concluded his lecture that went something like this. Since there's no such thing as any historical evidence of the resurrection, the religious tradition of the church has no ground. Because it's based on a relationship with a risen Savior who, in fact, never rose from the dead in any literal sense. And then he says, are there any questions? Well, I was silent for a while, and then an old preacher stood up in the back of the auditorium. He says, well, mister, I got one question. And as soon as he stood up, all eyes kind of focused on this aged minister. He took from his sack an apple, and he began to chew on the apple, crunching and munching and making statements. He said, you know, my question's a simple question. Continued chewing on the apple. Now, I've never read those books you've read, munching on his apple. And I don't know those scholars that you referenced. Continue to munch on the apple. And he goes, and I can't recite scripture in the original Greek, chewing on the apple. But when he finished the apple, he says, all I want to know is, the apple I just ate, was it bitter or sweet? And the philosopher paused for a moment, and then answered in a perfectly scholarly way, how can I possibly answer that question? I've never tasted of your apple. And the white-haired preacher dropped the core of the apple into his crumbled bag and said, you've never tasted of Jesus either. So why are you talking about one you do not know about? Why are you talking about one who you've never experienced? And the whole auditorium erupted with applause and cheers. And of course, the esteemed philosopher made his way off the platform. Once the Apostle Paul tasted of the glory of the risen Christ, he knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that absolutely nothing could compare to the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ. And with that knowledge came unquenchable joy and peace and courage and confidence. You know, one of the most haunting questions in the church has been, what if Paul had said no on that Damascus Road experience? Would all of history change if he refused to follow Jesus? But I have a question that's far more penetrating. What if you and I said yes? What if we here in this room said yes wholeheartedly to following Jesus, no matter what that cost may entail? How would that transform our lives, impact our families, touch our co-workers and or our associates? Even change our community. Question to think about. Well, let's stand together, if you would, at this time.